I want to call on the Princess of Arise, Princess Deum Adedo Insholare, our African Princess, all here to introduce the Girl Child Network and to introduce Muzvare Betty Makoni herself.
We might go up there. Can you just to hold it at this?
Your Excellency, the High Commissioner of Nigeria to Ireland, Mayors, Your Worshipful Mayor, distinguished Rotarians, I am also a Rotarian myself, and of course, the beautiful people of Nigeria and Ireland and everywhere else. My job is very, very brief. I bring you warm royal greetings from the heart of Nigeria. I'm the granddaughter of His Royal Majesty, of our William Christopher Adedo the II, the Akarigbo of Remoland. That's in Nigeria, the most beautiful country in the world. Alongside Ireland, and the UK, and the rest of the world. We love to share our beauty with the rest of the world. I also bring you greetings as the chair of the Girl Child Network Worldwide. The Girl Child Network Worldwide was set up by a young woman in a village in Zimbabwe, a village called Chitungwiza. And little known to her, the world was waiting for what she had. She had created a model whereby girls who were impoverished, girls who were disadvantaged, girls who had been subject to rape and all manner of abuse are now being given the opportunity to be rescued and to also have a better quality of life. She went on to become the CNN top hero of 2009. She's an Ashoka fellow. She has stood on the same stages as the Dalai Lama, the late Nelson Mandela, Gracia Michelle, and the list goes on. Time magazine listed her as one of the 150 women who shake our world. And she has over 42 national and international awards under her belt. But the beauty about this wonderful woman is that, to me, she still is that little girl who came out of that village called Chitungwiza. She is that woman of passion who wants to touch every girl child that she has the opportunity to meet. Today, we have looked over 375,000 girls, both in Africa and worldwide. And this is an organization set up by one person. I stand here boldly to say she has put governments of countries to shame. She has put organizations and agencies across the world to shame. Not in a bad way, but in a challenging way. It just shows us that where there's a will, there's a way. If you want to do something, just put your heart to it. Be passionate about it, and with the grace of God, trust you me, you will get there. Because the most important thing for us at Girl Child Network is to ensure that every single girl on the face of the planet, particularly in Africa, does not have to be subjected to abuse, kidnappings, killings, rape, oppression, lack of education, forced marriages, and the list goes on and on and on. After all, the female cannot become an endangered species. It is not possible. I'm very grateful to have met this woman that God enabled our paths to cross many years ago. I became the chair of the charity, and together we have passionately worked every day making sure that each child has a better quality of life. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the honor to present to you today, the founder, the CEO of Girl Child Network Worldwide, Her Royal Highness Muzvare Betty Makoni. Awards from the books that she sells, I know because I work with accountants, goes straight back to the charity. It's a self-funded charity. I think we need more people like this on the face of this planet so that our ecosystem can be a better place. Muzvare Betty Makoni.
His Excellency the Ambassador, Lord Mayor, our former Minister of Education, Your Royal Highness, Princess Dewa Dodein Sobalani, our founder of Women for Love International, and said the woman I most respect in the world. I know there are some people who are feeling very ordinary today. I want to tell you, because you are coming for this event, you are extraordinary in your own way. So thank you so much for coming. Thank you. What I want to do is, we are faced with a global crisis. I worked in my country, Zimbabwe, and as you can see, I'm Yoruba or Igbo or whatever you want to call me. Yes, I've heard you saying, oh, we Nigerians, but I also want to say we Africans.
That's right.
I came from Tanzania, then we crossed over Swaziland, and then we went to actually invade the people in Zimbabwe, and we conquered there as a kingdom. So Africans conquering Africans, I think we have had our own wars from way back. The thing is that we have never sat down to admit, make peace, sit on a round table like this, and then make the lives of our children move forward. Because we are so hurt with the past that we stick to it as if it is the only thing. How can religion, how can something like religion stop a girl from going to school? Because if anything, religion will be better with girls who can read the Shirai, who can read the Bible. If our women are empowered, we are also empowered. So I don't know where we are getting lost as Africans. I don't know why the abductions of the girls from Chibok should remain a Nigerian issue. Once you touch one girl, you touch all of us. So I want to say we are in it, we must actually not ask anyone to bring the girls back, because they won't. We are going to take them back. And you know what, these abductions are not isolated to Nigeria. I just want to make something clear as an African woman. I had a hard time in Zimbabwe chasing after an apostolic faith church. They did their abductions very innocently in church. Girls are seated there, and then a man stands up to say, God gave me this girl last night. And this is a 70-year-old man who is pointing to a 12-year-old girl. Then you say, well, how do you get to be given a 12-year-old girl when women as brave as us are looking for men? How can God give you a little one? Because we are saying, come to us, boy, come to us. Don't go to the little ones. So, when I embarked on my rescue mission, guess what? I get to that little hut, because I used to also to wear my royal crown, and then I say, I'm also a spirit. I've come to haunt you and take the girls back. One day I remember, like with the Boko, is it Boko Haram? Yeah. Yes, I remember fighting. I actually fought to an extent. A girl nearly died when I was trying to pull her out of the house. Ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we have to go physical. Yeah.
really physical, because we still have people from the other century. The world has moved, the world has forgiven all these things. We are saying to the next generation of our girls, we are doctors, we are lawyers, we are going to be better than animals. So whoever is captivating our lawyers, our doctors in a forest, we are also extending reconciliation to say, come to the table and we talk and we move forward. My presentation, our partnership with Women of Love International started last year. What they did, they called us here, fundraise, and they gave us close to £2,000. And guess what we did with the money? ASA doesn't come from Zimbabwe. We went back to Zimbabwe, rescued about three girls who were married, and as I talk to you, they are finishing their degrees in accounts. Accountants are not in Nigeria, but she's Nigerian. So we are saying we are extending the wing of empowerment with Women of Love. They didn't say Women of Love Nigeria, they simply said Women of Love International. That's how different people are. People have embraced the differences. You know what? No matter how we fight, how we insult each other, skin, tribe, and other things will not change. It's us to change. So we are here tonight to simply say we are going to change. And change is going to be the new culture. So next, so you have to move faster. So you may ask, who is Betty Makoni? Much as I come from the royal family, I used to be a daughter of an, my father was actually brother to a millionaire, imagine. But out of his millions, he hated to put a coin on education. But you know what? With determination, I went on the streets of St. Mary's, a poor high-density suburb, started selling candles, tomatoes, onions. Because as an intelligent girl at 6 years, I knew the power to rise and to be the woman I want to be lies in my own legs, lies, not lies between my legs, but in my legs. I just wanted to challenge the status quo. I wanted to challenge the status quo that we expect girls to be in bedrooms and not in classrooms. I wanted to tell the world that even if my uncle was a millionaire and I was coming from a royal family, there was that time of weakness, a time of poverty, but I had to break the vicious cycle of poverty. I had to tell poverty to go and to leave me alone. So with my big basket, I used to travel around, but I was very unfortunate at age 7, one man lured us and raped 10 of us in the neighborhood. So I'm also a victim of rape whilst trying to liberate myself from poverty. So you are just looking at that little girl who used to stay on the market. If you tell me to sell anything tonight, I will end up selling all of you. Because I learned the trade on the market. So this is me, you can see St. Dominic's, my school. This is me and my brother. This is me as a graduate, and I never forgot to go back to my village to tell girls that the world is bigger than a small village. You rise. Education can liberate you. I went back to my village after completing my 2 degrees at the University of Zimbabwe. And mind you, I worked for my school fees at a Roman Catholic school for girls. All girls could go back home during holidays, and I remained at school, cleaning toilets. Most of you who are in the medical field, you know that bacteria kills. I tell you, if you are as poverty stricken as me, bacteria doesn't kill you, actually kill bacteria. You are the one who actually beat bacteria one by one. So I cleaned the toilets, I never got sick. And out of cleaning toilets, all my tuition fee at a girls' boarding school, like the minister was saying, boarding schools for girls are great. That's where I came from. Resilient, strong, and I said, with this resilience, I want to transform myself. I want to be that girl who ran after one school bus and caught it because women at the marketplace said, stop for a poor girl running after you. I wanted to go back again and give back. I'm not here because I was given millions of dollars, like with the Rotarians. It's just a good woman who saw the potential in me and said, if I give $50, like 20 pounds, Betty will be the woman that she wants to be. So I worked throughout everything you see here, be it my makeup, my cutex, my shoes, I worked for them. This is the same message I returned to my girls to say, nobody is going to chase after you with opportunity. You chase after opportunity. So we started, I know Plan International talked about their campaign. Because I'm a girl, amazing. We are encouraging every corner to start something, even in your home. Start something. Huh? If you're a mother with six girls, as you know, in Africa, they say, if you've got six girls, they are not woman enough. A lot of men don't know that they are the ones who make the girls to be there as fathers, not us. They are the ones with the chromosome, which determines the sex of the child. But normally it's blamed on women. Knowledge. Lack of knowledge is very dangerous. So what we did, with all the suffering I went through, with all the work that we did, we started a campaign called Never Again. We just woke up one day with my biography, autobiography of 600 pages, and I said, from today onwards, whatever happened to me, to my grandmother, to my mother who died in domestic violence when I was age 9, and I had to be a mother at that age, should not happen to any woman or a girl again. So we started a Never Again campaign. Never again should we see children abducted in Africa. Never again. So we started that and it crossed over. We went on, you can go to the next slide, to build girls' empowerment villages. As you can see, it's almost like what the minister said. But if you rape a girl, we rescue the girl, she comes to my shrine. Once she comes to my shrine, I get to know about it, automatically you go to jail. So we summon you. And you know what? This is our sacred place for the princesses. All men who come to our sacred place, what they simply do is to clap their hands and listen. Men are not allowed to talk at our place. I don't know why in other African countries we did not identify the power given to women, because we always search for it, isn't it? Women in Africa have got specially designated places where